Please rise. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. He is risen indeed. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. A very blessed Easter to each and every one of you. What a magnificent day to come together in fellowship and see all that God has done for us in our Lord Jesus Christ. The forgiveness of sins that he offers to us, the salvation that he has won for us, the life that he has secured for us. Through this past season of Lent, we've been hearing through God's word that he calls for his people to return to him. We have heard the different sins committed against our Lord Jesus through the course of his blessed passion, which leads us to consider our sinfulness, how we are to remain in God's call to return to him, and what that comfort brings to us are heard in these words from the prophet Joel. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, and he relents from doing harm. Our attention keeps coming back, keeps coming back, keeps coming back to Jesus and the sacrifice that he has made to reconcile you and me to our Father who is in heaven. Today all comes together as Jesus is raised from the dead and invites his disciples to come and to see him. Why? When they see Jesus risen from the dead, then they will understand the importance of everything that he has accomplished during his 3 years of ministry. They will, as Scripture tells us, comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. That awareness will compel them to share the holy gospel, the good news with others, that they too might come to know the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding. But first, let's back up just a little bit, and let's listen to what Isaiah tells us as he looks 700 years prior into the future and gives us a picture of heaven. Isaiah writes, as you have heard read, on this mountain the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined. What a vivid picture Isaiah paints for us. A joyful gathering of people from all tribes and all peoples and all languages. In society, we are being separated all the time. But God does not do this. He brings us all together in fellowship in his kingdom. Come, Lord Jesus, come quickly indeed. In this gathering, the Lord of hosts has destroyed the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Lord Jesus, the Christ, has defeated death forever and has removed the consequence of your sin and my sin that would otherwise mean eternal separation from God eternally. All this sounds rather appealing, doesn't it? We read Isaiah's words We picture the fulfillment of those words, and we long to be there with our Lord Jesus Christ. But how? How does this happen? This covering is cast over all peoples because, and you know this well, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The word all is important. There is no exception. Each one of you have sinned. I have certainly sinned. I know that well. And we fall short of the glory of God. All means every single human being who has lived, who is living, and will live. This covering is cast over us all. And you can't shake it. You can't uncover yourself. Your sinful nature clings to you as you stubbornly, so stubbornly that you cannot strip yourself of it. And dear one, you and I know this. Your conscience cries out against you, and your thoughts accuse you every single waking moment. You know this. I know this. And we together lament. We lament. Who then can be saved? Can you be saved? Can I be saved? And Jesus lovingly replies, with man, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. God dealt with our sin problem. He provided. He gave his all, his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. God stepped in for you. God made it possible for you. God made it possible in and through your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In Jesus, your sin is forgiven. In Christ, your salvation has been secured. In Christ, you have an advocate with the Father. You have a defense attorney, in other words. And he is the perfect defense attorney. Each and every one of us would want him on our side. Jesus is perfectly righteous, an advocate who lived the perfect life and then turned around and offered his righteousness freely to each and every one of you. A free gift. Why would you refuse it? He has clothed you with pure vestments in return for your filthy garments. Think about that for a moment. Jesus took on our filth and he gave to us his righteousness, his glorious robe of righteousness. Through baptism, Jesus has wrapped you and me in the robe of righteousness, which covers all our sins. In Jesus Christ, you have been forgiven. In Christ, your salvation has truly been secured. You now have a seat at his table. You are now invited to his feast. Isaiah gives voice to our response this morning. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. The blessed resurrection, this blessed resurrection, Jesus emerges from the tomb, raised from the dead. He is fully alive. And his very first task was to invite his disciples to Galilee to come and to see. This morning, he extends the very same invitation to each and every one of you. Come and see. Come and see the one who was pierced for you. Come and see the one so that that plan of salvation in him has now been completed for you. Come and see. Yes, come and see what he has prepared for you. Your resurrection, your eternal life. Come and see. But how? Where? Jesus told his disciples, come to Galilee. Come to the mountain where you will find me. And they did. They came to the mountain and they gathered at their Lord's feet. And he gave them a commission. It was simple, a very simple commission, yet very vital. You have come. You have seen. You have worshiped. Now go. Go and make disciples. Go and baptize. Go and teach. Go and know that I, your Lord, am with you always, even to the end of the age. Come and see. Then go and tell. Yet, we don't have a mountain to go to. Jesus says, come to me. And we stand like Thomas at the Last Supper, gawking at Jesus, stunned by his words. How can we know the way? How can we know the way? God gives us his way. He gives us his church. That is to say, we know where to find Jesus. You know where to find Jesus. Since God's promise and his word makes it crystal clear to each and every one where you will find him. You will always find Christ in, as we hear from our confessions, the assembly of all believers, among whom the gospel is purely preached and the holy sacraments are administered according to the gospel. And then Jesus tells us, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them. There I am in the midst of them. This morning you have come to this place, this blessed Easter morn, because it is here, dear one, it is here where you hear about Jesus and where you actually see Jesus. You gaze on the cross of his crucifixion and you ponder the penalty of your sin, which he gladly bore for you, gladly bore for you. You see him reach down and claim you as his own in the waters and by the power of the word in holy baptism, as you have recently witnessed here. You taste and see that the Lord is good, as you will soon receive his holy body and his holy blood. It is here, dear one, where you come and where you see him. Then what? Then what? We human beings are always asking questions, and this is one of them. Then what? It is no different for us than it was for the disciples then. Come and see. Go and tell. Isaiah's words this morning are truly beautiful. Behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. That is the pattern that Almighty God lays out for all Christians, you and me included. We trust, we wait, he acts. Then we rejoice and share the holy gospel, the good news, with others, and we are not ashamed. So simple, very powerful. Finally, today, this blessed morn, you have now come, and you will soon see the salvation won for you by your Lord and Savior. You will even sing of it. You may be moved to go out into the world and share this good news with your neighbor, with your coworker, with your friend. Be glad and rejoice in him and share that good news with the whole world. For in the Lord's resurrection, Almighty God has brought life and immortality to light. He has sealed your redemption and the forgiveness of all mankind. He has proclaimed victory over the evil one. Satan has no power over you. He has transformed death, spiritual death, into spiritual victory forever. And he has given to you, dear one, freely. He has given you freely the blessed assurance, the hope of life eternal. Hallelujah. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah indeed. And in the name of Jesus, amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.